Hello. Good afternoon, all. I hope it's audible.
Yeah, it's audible, Rajleshma.
So welcome all to our 14th session today. Lithin Abraham will be taking class for us. Hello.
Hello.
Lithin Abraham have been working with Pallium India for last couple of years. He is our senior social worker. So I welcome you, sir, to take a session for us.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm going to take a class, a session on psychosocial care, the importance of psychosocial care and palliative care. So let's begin then. Okay, next slide. Okay, so the World Health Organization has given a definition to what palliative care is. Basically, if we can understand, like, even the very definition of health also, it says that it's a state of complete physical, psychological, and social well-being of an mental and the social well-being of an individual, not merely an absence of an infirmity or a disease. So in the same way, most of the times what happens is, like, when a patient is approaching a particular hospital, most of the time the physical treatments or physical diagnosis are being done, and at the same time, like, the other aspects, like the maybe the psychological aspects or the spiritual aspects or the social aspects, are at times ignored, which may be actually assisting to the total pain that the person would be having. The same way, so the World Health Organization has defined palliative care as that it's an approach which improves the quality of life of patients and families. So in palliative care, we just don't look at improving the quality of life of patients, but we also look into to improve the quality of life for the families also. So these family, these patients would be associated with life-threatening illness. So what we try to do is that we try to prevent and give relief for the suffering that they are going through by identification, by early identification, and doing an impeccable assessment, and also the associated problems that they are having, not just physical but also psychosocial as well as spiritual. Next slide. So why is psychosocial care important to all of us? Because the thing is that if we can just imagine for ourselves, if tomorrow I am a very healthy person, if tomorrow if I am being, like, having a life limiting illness, or suddenly one day I have been diagnosed with a life limiting illness, so, and I know that within a few days but I am just awaiting death, so at that time all the plans and all the things that I had considered in my life, and because every human being has their own understanding about the future, what they are supposed to do. So even every individual has and also maybe I would be the only breadwinner of the family, so I would be actually worried about my family, so I will be actually very much stressed out on what's happening around, and also how my life is going to go forward. So that is so, if at that moment if somebody comes to me and tries to know what my problem is and tries to improve my quality of life and give me the appropriate care, actually I will be very helpful that somebody was able to understand and talk to me and provide for me the things which I actually wanted to do in my life. So that is why psychosocial care is important, because when a patient because it's a new challenge that they are going to face. So if we can provide them the appropriate care at that time, we can talk to them and know their problems, and if you provide an appropriate care to them, I think that will be very much helpful for them. Okay, next slide. So accurate, detailed and timely assessment is vital in understanding the issues that influence the well-being of the mean by taking this assessment. So this assessment involves collecting information, and while collecting that information, we can identify the strengths that they are having, the resources they have, and also we can know the needs that they are having. So we can assess that too. So, and also maybe in the first session, I may get a few information. So we can't just limit our assessment for one session. It's actually an ongoing process. So, because every moment, the patient would be with you for a period of time, and you would be seeing that person after 3 months' time. So, maybe the needs of that person would have changed. So, if you take an assessment every visit that you go, if you take that assessment, I think you can very accurately know what all requirements and needs they're having. So, accordingly, you can provide the appropriate intervention for them. Next slide. So the lived experience of the patient and family cannot be seen without going beyond the borders of disease and its treatment. At times what happens is that we just focus on what the disease is and how we are going to treat it. But the other problem that they are facing, at times we ignore it. So that would be something that would be actually hurting them the most. And also, as we speak about, as maybe already the class on the session on pain has already been done. So, as we would know that pain is not just one aspect; it doesn't have just one aspect. It also have the other aspects, which includes maybe a patient would be having a physical pain. If, for example, if I can take an example of myself, I may be having a physical pain, but if I am actually going through a malady in my family, so those. That emotional pain can also actually assist and increase my physical pain that I am having. Though I am not much stressed with the physical pain, but the psychological or the emotional pain that I am facing, that may also actually very much come in line with it. So it's so we cannot differentiate between physical pain as well as the emotional pain that a person is having. Okay, next slide. So as it was already told you, so assessment, when we do an assessment for a patient, it's not just, we just don't look at one of the aspects, but we look at all the four aspects, which is the physical, psychological, socioeconomic, as well as the spiritual pain. I can give you an example, if a person is is the only breadwinner of the family, if that person has to look after two kids and his wife is not employed, so if that is the case, then if now this patient is having a life-limiting illness, there is nobody to take care of them. So the education of the children gets affected. The income of the family gets affected. And also, so actually that would also be extra stresses, which would be actually increasing the anxiety of the patient. So if we do an impeccable assessment of all the four aspects, then I think we can provide the appropriate care for them. Okay, next slide. So, assessing psychosocial and spiritual suffering. So, while we assess psychosocial and spiritual suffering, there are two things that we need to particularly look on to. One is purposeful observation and purposeful conversations. So, I'll just explain to you what is purposeful observations and purposeful conversations are. Next slide. Okay, so purposeful observations and conversations may include patient's cultural and religious beliefs, preferences, what they prefer, their fears that they have within them, grief, if anything particular they have, their view of quality of life. I can't predict the quality of life of a particular person, but only I know what can better my quality of life. So I cannot predict others. So their view of, we need to understand the patient's view of life and the family relationship. If the family relationships are tense, that may also sometimes add on to the pain. And the views of dying of the patient, how he wishes to die, maybe some religious background or we can't say, we can't like just say that if that person wishes to be like cremated that person would be a Christian, so he doesn't follow the I'm not supposed to say so. So if that person is a Christian, he wants to follow some other way of dying, so or his views of dying would be different. So we need to like ask the patient and know what his problem is, and accordingly we can fulfill it. And also importantly, we need to what we do over here is that firstly, when we see a patient, we always try to know from the patient their understanding about the diagnosis as well as the prognosis, whether they understand it or not. We try to understand that. And also, if the patient is having any anxiety, any depression, or any phobias, etc., that also we can understand. And also, any suicidal thoughts. So, through our observation and conversations, we need to actually get all these things that could be actually helpful for the person. Next slide. Okay. So, we speak about spiritual suffering. So psychosocial and spiritual suffering is actually real. We cannot say that it's just for namesake, but it's actually very real. And at times it is very difficult for us to understand what it is. Maybe a person would be before a doctor or before a social worker, the person would be very cheerful, but what is, we can't understand what is actually going through their mind. And also psychosocial and spiritual suffering can be translated into physical complaints, as I have told it. So, okay, next slide. So in spiritual pain, while we do a spiritual assessment, we try to know what is the patient's description of their spirituality. It's not about a particular deity. It's about to know how do they describe their spirituality. And what are their faiths and beliefs, and what are their expectations, and how do they cope with it? Next slide, please. Okay, so here I have given you a detail about the spiritual assessment. It's been done by Max Sherry. So these four things we try to focus upon. Firstly, the connection. Who are the person or communities you look for support? Or what role do they have in your care? Do you have an image of a power greater than yours? So you can ask this question to the patient in order to know to take the spiritual assessment. Has your life situation affected your feelings about yourself, your faith, or your relationship? If you ask this question to them, you can like, get to know how do that person gets connected with it. At times, for example, like if we can say it's not necessary that it should be a particular person. It could be a particular thing too, or a pet that would be closer to the person. So we can it's not necessary that it should always be God or someone as such. And secondly, what we can understand is like when we seek for the meaning and joy. So I happened to once ask a patient that what is the most important thing that you feel in your life. So the person happened to tell me that my daughter's birth, her growth, that was the most I felt her success. That was the most important thing that I have felt in my life. And whenever she used to get success, that used to actually provide a particular joy to my heart. So it's like different for every individual. Also, we can know what are their strengths or what is the comfort that they are presently getting in. And also, we can assess if they are having any particular hopes or anything that they felt, that any concerns they have, that they feel that they haven't completed it. If we can help them to complete these questions, I think you can take up a proper spiritual assessment. This is the model that we follow over here in Palliam India. Okay, next slide. Okay. The next thing is socioeconomic assessment. while we take the socioeconomic assessment, we need to, the things that we focus on is who is the breadwinner of the family, whether it's the patient or the caregiver or who supports the family, and the source of income. Now, maybe the of the family is ill or is actually is having a life-limiting illness. So what is the source of income they are having? Do they have any debts or any loans if they are having so? We can understand that. What if the children are studying? How? What about their education? How are they, as the education stopped, what is going to happen? And who all are the dependents in the family? Whether is it a nuclear family or is it a joint family? And any schemes or pensions which are available for the family, if we can try to understand that too, then accordingly we can support them better in the future. Next slide. Okay. So these are the interventions that we particularly provide, which is like, if a need be, we conduct family meetings. At times we provide supportive counseling. And also cognitive behavioral therapy based communication we provide for them. Also, if we need to speak to them about certain things, be much educational to them. At times we conduct the psychosocial, psychoeducational support groups also. And the other thing is, which we often provide over here is a bereavement support. Maybe the patient has passed away after the first 4 weeks, we conduct a bereavement call, and then we conduct the visit. If we have a tool on the basis of that, if we find out that this patient needs to have a visit, the multidisciplinary team goes for a visit. And also we provide emotional support and recommendation for education support, at times traveling allowance, food kit. Those are the support that we provide in Pallium India. And also at times, as I already told you, that if the patient is a breadwinner and there is nobody, there is no other source of income for them, maybe we can like help support the family by providing any vocational training to the spouse, so that they would be much more helped with. And maybe we can also facilitate after giving the vocational training. Also, we can, after they make the materials, if we can provide a platform on which they can sell those things, maybe they can get those income also. Something, these sort of interventions normally we carry out here in Pallium India. Okay, next slide. Okay. So as we know that social support, the person would not need just when the when the patient is suffering, maybe after the patient's death too, at the time of bereavement also, they may be going through the same social problem that they are having. So if we provide appropriate, if our care needs to be appropriate, we can provide the social support even at the time of treatment as well as after the bereavement, unless they reach up a level when they can look after themselves. So these are the things that we do over here. As I already told you, educational support, food kit, vocational rehabilitation, and travel aid. Travel aid, come to the hospital if they need, if they are, like if they come to the hospital, if they don't have money enough, so we provide the travel aid too. Okay. Okay, next slide. So vocational rehabilitation, as I already told you, it's to stabilize the family income, to encourage the family to become self-dependent, and financial security of the family, and also to engage the family. At times, during a bereavement process, at times what happens is that the patient would be, the person would be like very much in grief. So if we can like help them with some vocational rehabilitation, maybe they can, if we can engage the family into something, so slowly and steadily they can come over that sorrow which they are actually going through. Next slide. So these are the vocational rehabs that we have provided. Some of the snaps being taken from that we have provided. A vegetable cultivation, cattle rearing, goat rearing, poultry farming. Next slide. We have started up certain petty shops for individuals. I thought stitching, shop on wheels, fish vending. These are some of the supports that we have provided. Okay. So that's it. That's all about the psychosocial support that I wanted to present to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Lithin. So today we are having our social team join with us. We have Praveen, Viju, Siddhik, Sana, and Reshma joining with us. So we can hear something from them if they have something to say on.
Please unshare the screen.
Hello everyone, my name is Praveen. I'm a medical social worker in Pallium, India. I am working here for last 6 months. I have gone through all the topics, all the things which Lithin have shared with us. It was very informative. That one of the main thing which came to my mind when I was listening to his session, this all this psychosocial thing, that psychosocial aspects or psychosocial care is thoroughly based on evidence. Evidence in the sense that for each and every patient, they have their own social situations, emotional situations, spiritual situations, and so on. So we have to, when we approach a patient, we have to concentrate on various sessions which we do with them, and we have to try to find out various evidences through that interactions. Through evidences, I mean that Lithin have shared us various interventions, what we do for our patient, just like vocational training, cattle rearing, and all that things we used to provide. But at the same time, when it comes to a support, mainly the support means that we have to identify what their need is. That is very important. For some patients, they will be very much financially sound. They have a lot of social support. And we will, in the first session, we will interact with them. We will find out, they will tell us that we are okay. We have financial support. I have my father, my relatives to help us. We doesn't have any need, or they will be pretty silent. In that way, when we, in the primary observations, we will see that everything is okay for them. But this, the very, very much important aspect of this psychosocial care is continuity and follow. When we talk about a patient, we have to keep on doing sessions with them. Then only we will identify what their need is. As just like Lithin told, that patient who is approaching their end, or who are suffering with a life-threatening, knowing that illness, they will be having lots of desires in their mind. For example, I will tell you, one of our patients had a desire to celebrate their anniversary. It is a very personal occasion. They won't share with us that incident to us in the first session itself. It may take one or two or more than sessions to share that personal incident or personal thing with us. That is a very striking and important thing which every medical professional have to understand. This is my opinion about the psychosocial care. Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you, Lithin and Praveen. These sessions, I think we have covered about 13 or 14 sessions, and we were talking about physical aspects of management of patients. But now we are today coming into the one of the most important aspect, which is psychosocial and spiritual care. Whenever a patient comes, we should not only look into the physical matters, but also the psychosocial and spiritual aspects of the care. Sometimes the patient will have only mild physical problems, but they will have very big or huge psychosocial problems or spiritual problems. So if we give the physical support at that time, it will not be enough for the patient to come through that stage. So it is our duty to find out the psychosocial aspects of the problem. But the important thing is it is very difficult for us to find out the find out these problems, because most of the patients will not reveal it to a person who is seeing them for the first time. So first of all, you have to have a good rapport with the patient. So this rapport, you can get it through good communication with the patient. And then only they will reveal all the problems to you. So rapport building is one of the most important step in psychosocial care. And spiritual care is one of the important problem, and Lithin has shown you some of the aspects through which you have to assess the spiritual problems. The spiritual care is not very much evolved in Indian palliative care practice, but it is it has a very big role, and it has evolved very much in Western countries like UK or US. So I think you can ask any doubts to our social workers. Anybody? Okay, Jyoti has a question. She's asking why spiritual care is important in Western countries. As you know, the palliative care, it started actually the modern palliative care. It started from UK, and the developed countries has very good penetration of palliative care. So, as you know, palliative care not only concentrated in physical, psychological, social, or physical well-being, and also the spiritual care of the patient. In Western countries, they take the chaplains has is taking a very important role in spiritual care. It is not only from the religious domain, but also from other domains also. So. Maybe because of they are the countries which has started palliative care very early. That may be one of the reason why it is why spiritual care is given so much importance in other countries. But it is also good to note that spiritual care has a very good role in palliative care. We have to do that also. But because of many problems like lack of resources, we are not doing it in a very good manner. But still, we do spiritual care. Lithin, do you want to comment?
Yeah, I think so. That even spiritual aspects, like if a person is having, I just the other day gone for a home visit, so with Rajagopal sir, so he told me a particular aspect which I felt that it is very essential when we meet patients. Daughter was looking after the mother, so there was like lot of resistance from all the family members, but still the daughter was looking after the mother. So at that time sir told me that appreciating her for what she is doing, actually that is one sort of spiritual care that we can provide for them. So that is something that we can do if as we meet a patients and all, if we can if we find out that someone is doing something out of the box for a person, I think if we appreciate them, that is also a sort of spiritual care that we could provide for that person.
Okay, thanks Lithin. I would like you to understand that spiritual care is not the religious care as such. It can also include religious care, but it is not the only thing which is included in spiritual care. So I don't know if we ask our chaplains here to involve in spiritual care, they may come up with some religious care. That's that will be one of our big worries, because we should not imply our religious thing on someone else. If our chaplains, if they are trained well and to look into the spiritual aspect, not only from the religious side, then they can also take part into spiritual aspect. But I don't think we have many chaplains who will look into spiritual care from the true aspect of spiritual care. Anyone else?
Any more doubts?
Krishna Omar has a question. Rajalakshmi, can you read it?
Yes, sir. Financial support for terminal ill patients. Any more modalities there? Have you seen it, Lithin?
Yeah. Actually, we have like some. There are a lot of government schemes which are available. So I think most of the people are like ignorant about it. So what we try to do is that if any government schemes are available, so we try to attach it for them. For example, like as we all may be knowing about it, that every cancer patient has a pension of around, I think, 1,100 rupees per month. So what we do over here is that when we get to know about it, so we provide a form to them, so through which, and we tell them from where to get the things done, so the caregiver can go and get it. So like there are also other government schemes, like for children there are Talolam schemes, and also for Karunya pension, they also provide like 2 lakh rupees for the treatment purpose and all. So likewise, and also like for the, you may be aware of it, like for the disabled, for the caregivers, there is a pension, there is a scheme called the Ashwasa Girna. It's actually for the caregivers who is looking after the patient for a long time. So that's, I think that's part of Kerala, I think so. So likewise, the various government schemes are available. If we can like find it out, we can actually, I think, provide some help accordingly.
One more question. Are those schemes available or linked with NGOs like you, sir?
Are those schemes available or linked with
NGOs like us?
Lithin?
Yeah. I didn't actually get the question properly.
I think what they meant was, is it only available to the NGOs, or is it something that is coming through NGOs? Is that what meant?
Yes.
For everyone, not just for NGOs. It's available for everyone.
Krishnamar, it is available for everybody. And the problem is that many of us don't know what schemes there are for these patients. So actually, there is a book which is available, which is known as Vazhi Vilakku, and I think which you can download from government website also, which mentions about the schemes available or supports available to the patients. So there are various schemes, I think as many as 200 types of schemes available for patients and families. So I think it's our duty to go through this book and find out which one is suitable. So I think our social workers have a copy of that book, and they know about what schemes available for patients which are suitable for each patient.
And also, it's not just for the government patients, it's for everybody, every patient. Thank you.
So, any more queries?
Praveen, or if your colleagues has anything to add to what we have discussed till now. If there is nothing, we can move on to the patient story. Jyoti has a question. If it is a patient in a private hospital,
through these schemes, if it's a patient in private hospital, so is it applicable to patients in private hospital? That is.
When we go for the schemes, they have certain standards or documents which they ask, and I think on the basis of that only it's being provided. I don't think that a person with enough, like if they have enough financial assistance, I don't think that they may get a help as such. But the poor people, whether wherever they are going, but in a private hospital, like for example, for the kidney patient for taking dialysis, and only if they go for a go to a private hospital, and I think some of the schemes are not available to via private hospitals.
And there is one more question from Krishna Omar. Is there any modalities to include the spiritual thing in a tertiary care center?
I think that when we speak about spiritual care, it's about the spirituality that a person has in himself. It's not something which the society imposes on him. So it is something which he has in himself. So I think if we could get that aspect done for every person, I think that would be very much helpful, because at times people need that care too. At times we forget to take care of them. At times we need that care too.
I think there are more questions. Rajalakshmi, can you read this?
Sir, Jishnu, Dr. Jishnu has asked about the cost of the cattle and goat which we provide as rehab. So can you speak on it, Lithin?
Lithin or Praveen?
Okay, I'll speak. So normally what we do over this here is that when we take an assessment of it, so what we do is we give the patient report, and we have a rehab team who goes and assesses the condition. They do another assessment, and they also then finally it is being submitted over here. And actually I think it's from Palliam India's general fund, actually we provide it. And also we have certain funds through which we provide it at times.
I think one of the important thing will be, if somebody asks for some type of rehabilitation, suppose if it is for goat rearing or cow rearing, we should go and see the patient situation and surroundings of the patients, his home, etc. Because if there is not enough place for a cow or goat, then it would be difficult. If we give that goat or cow, then it will be difficult for them to rear them. So it's the job of the volunteers or the people in the rehab team to assess the condition of the patient and his home, and then recommend proper rehabilitation. That is one of the most important thing. Otherwise, what will happen? You will give some rehabilitation, but after some time, when you go to reassess this rehabilitation, then you will not see anything there. So that's also important. I think there was one more question. Raja Lakshmi.
Sir, lot of patients are going behind some non-medical authorities for disease relief under behalf of spirituality. So, it was asked by Dr. Krishna Umar.
So, what is the question? It's a statement, isn't it?
Krishna,
I think...
No questions. Okay. So he just asked a question based on the other question he asked before. So is there any more queries you need to know? So can we move to case presentation now? I hope it can be seen. Dr. Jishnu, you can start.
Good evening all. Audible?
Yes, you are. Okay.
So actually this is not a medical case, it's just something related to the clinical social aspects, related to three case scenarios which I have seen during my after my MBBS. So next slide. Okay. This is a case scenario one. During 2016, I am working in government hospital Tenmala PHC, and we usually go to, we have a palliative day, that is usually Wednesday, and we go from the PHC, we go in a chief sister and pharmacy. So there was a man who was working as a forest watcher. It's not permanent, temporary watcher. That time they have not taken them as permanent. So he was 53-year-old male patient having a son, wife and two daughters, and got CVA and systemic hypertension was the complaint. He was now left side paralysis patient. Next slide. Next, okay. Actually, when I came there, he was on palliative treatment. History is known as he was a known case of systemic hypertension for past 15-20 years. But he was a chain smoker and alcoholic. Next slide. He is moderately built, conscious oriented, and at that time his BP was almost stable. He was able to walk the help of others. Now the main aspect was that after his illness he cannot go to work. He was the only breadwinner of his family, and now he was very much depressed, and the family start to sell some things. Even they sell the chair, sell for buying something. He was getting adequate medicines and weekly visits from the PHC. So medical aspect is okay, but the financial things was very bad. Okay. He was also worried about his dependability too, and his wife has to stay with him even to go to bathroom like that. He was very worried. And one more thing, was son was not getting a job because the forest department can take him as the temporary in for replacing his father's view. Okay. Then we went and talked with the DFO. DFO was Shanavasar, and he was okay. And then he took him as helper of cook. That we asked him to give him that post because being the helper of cook means in forest camps he will get tip. That will be giving an added advantage to his income. After 1 year, now last November I think so, all the temporary staffs are made permanent. So now he is a permanent government staff. And last December I think we went there. He was very happy. He was moving around. He was okay. Family has started to improve like that. This is case scenario 2. During a routine medical camp in Ponmudi area, that was also in 2016, a 60-year-old female was taken to the camp by her son, complaining of very bad smell from right from body. And when we examined, we saw discharge and from right breast. Patient was conscious oriented febrile. Okay. Huge ulcer was there with the maggots. One maggot was there. And the ulcer was suggestive of CA breast. Okay, the team done a C&D, gave oral antibiotics and advised the patient to go to Trivandrum Medical College or RCC. The son was willing to take her, but she was not. She was not at all agreeing to go to hospital. She just went to some local Vaidyans. They gave her some oil, some powder like that, which she used to apply. And after 2 months, when I contacted the ranger there, that he told that lady died 2 weeks back, like that. This aspect is that even after advanced medical supports available and everybody is there to help, even the son was ready to take her, but she was adamant not to go to medical. This is case scenario 3. He was a well-educated male patient. Family was very well, not middle class, he was a high class. People having lymphoma and taking treatment from a tertiary care hospital in Ernakulam, and now presented to the casualty with urticaria. Next slide. From history, it was suggested that he was taking some local substance. He himself prepared it from the root of something which was given by a relative. Next. So we started this symptomatic management, started to give IV medication, and the caregivers now rise up and asking, is there any side effect for this medicine like that. So this aspect is that financially stable patient, well educated, on regular treatment from good hospital, now started to treat by his own with unknown plans, believing others blindly that so some relatives gave them this route will cure the disease and like that. My discussion, actually these topics was discussed right before my presentation. Some people still think modern medicine is harmful and land up in hands of some quacks and ruin their lives. What are the possibilities we can even after repeatedly we advise them, counsel them, but still somehow for some days they will, okay, we will start medication like that. Then some relatives will come, this is a good medicine, he will cure like that. Then they will go after them. What any other measures we can do to control it? The second topic we actually discussed. No need of again discussing.
Thank you, Dr. Jishnu. Lithin, you can speak now.
I think what we can do is that normally if we provide like enough awareness to them, and also it depends upon people to people and awareness to them. I think that's what we can do to them. As you already told that you had spoken it to them a lot of times, but still they are doing it. So something, I think that's what something we can do for them to like know that they are actually the help is available at another place. So that is something which we can do for them. And yeah. I think that at times we also at times listen from patients, feel that some Ayurveda things are there which can help them out, and some leaves and medicines available. So I think we can provide proper awareness. I think that could be actually, which can actually help them. That's what is my stand.
Actually, our social media is also playing a very bad role in the thing.
Yes, yes. I think they get most of this idea advice from WhatsApp and Facebook and all, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what can we do? Maybe we can inform the cyber team.
Is there any questions that we can, like some, for everything there is some clause, because you have to follow this protocol. If you are taking any other medicines, your treatment or your benefits will be cut like that. Something can be done. Possible?
I think it will not be possible.
It would be actually adding on to the. Yeah. It will be adding on to the trouble that they are having, right? Yes. Sir, you speak.
I think that will not be possible because it is the patient who, or patient or family, who needs to decide what treatment they need to take. So if they are taking something and if they want to opt for something else, then it's their decision to take that treatment. And the problem with that would be, we don't know what all medication will interact with so-called Ayurvedic or natural medicine, natural medications. We don't know how it is going to interact with modern medicines. So that would be a problem, but we know that many of our patients are taking Ayurveda along with modern medicines. That's a fact. I know that, Jyoti, I think you will have more experience in this because you are working in a tertiary care center and you will be seeing many of these patients. And most of them will be on multiple medications, Ayurveda, homeo, and even now the trend is going to Mysuru and getting some and for all types of cancer he is giving some one type of powder, and many of the patients and families knows that okay, they are getting only one medicine for whatever be the type of cancer, and they are taking it thinking that this will get cured, or they have had some stories of getting cured of some diseases. So that's how the patients and families get into their trap. So Jyoti, what's your experience?
I wanted to ask was, sir, in the first two scenarios, what we saw was The first patient was from Tenmala and the second patient was from Ponmudi. And both these shows that, okay, they are not like, they don't have any medical accessibility or it is less for them, because the most probable availability would be a PHC. And the third scenario was where the patient was, he was adequately educated. He didn't have to go behind Ayurvedic medicines. So the both scenarios, the confusing part is that if it is the lack of awareness, or is it like, even though you get educated, you still go behind Ayurvedic medicines. Why is it that, sir? I think it's maybe only in our place.
I'm not at all pointing against Ayurveda. Not against Ayurveda, okay?
No, actually I told this because actually there was a scenario in our hospital. What happened was, she was a 60-year-old female and she came with a huge ulcer of the right breast and it was excessively bleeding, and she had this breast lump for about 3 years. And she didn't reveal that to anyone unless and until they started seeing her dress getting soaked in blood. That's when they realized she had this history. And when she came, we couldn't control the bleeding. We had to, like, all the bandages were getting soaked. So I asked her why, like, what happened. We didn't blame her because she was not in such a situation. We just asked her, what happened? Why did you be so late? And that time she told me her neighbor also had, she was a case of carcinoma breast. And what happened was, they also took treatment, but still she died. So I asked, okay, what was the, just casually asked, what was the treatment, what happened? So that time I came to know that, the neighbors, like, sorry, her the patient's family members told me that, no, that actually she didn't take any treatment. She just took some treatment of her own. You know, just taking all kind of some homeo Ayurveda or a kind of alternative treatment. And because of that, the patient died due to disease progression. And this caused a kind of anxiety in our patient. And that is the only reason why she didn't come to any other hospital. And she is now at stage 4 right now. And her disease has been progressed. It's metastatic. And anyways, we know the prognosis is bad. So in such cases, how do we actually, you know, change such cases or change such scenarios? How do we help people in this?
I think this is a very difficult situation because many of the patient and the family will be influenced by experience of other people around them. And so they will not approach the doctors in modern medicine until it becomes something complicated. They will reach the modern medicine doctor only during the last stage of the disease. So at that stage, even modern medicine will not be able to do any a cure or even palliative interventions. So it will be difficult, and only during that time we will be able to provide them with supportive care. That's what we will be able to do. And you told, social media is a very big reason behind this making wrong assessments and wrong promise to the patients and families. So if somebody is posting something which is very wrong, and that is going to be circulated, and that is seen by many patients and families, and they will believe that, okay, we can undergo this treatment. Because this happens mainly to the patients who has a very advanced malignancy. Because once the malignancy is advanced, then we will not be able to do any oncological interventions, chemotherapy or radiotherapy or surgery. So then they hear that, okay, there is something else which is available treating the cancer. like powders or vitamins or something like that. Then when they hear about them, then they will hang on to that, because even if because the problem is if somebody has a terminal cancer, then they want to get it cured somehow without knowing that no, it will not get a cure. So that's a basic problem. I think that is the human's nature. So if there is something which can cure, let's give a try. And it may happen even with well-educated people. So that's a fact. I don't think this is going to be this will be a big problem, and even with more awareness, we can't fully reverse this situation. What we can do is we can advise, as we are practicing modern medicine, ask the people for evidence-based medicine, and suggest evidence-based medicine for the patients. That's I think that's what our duty is.
So I had a doubt, sir. So do you think this scenario is different in Western countries, unlike our country?
I think in developing countries, this will be the same. But in developed countries, it will be somewhat different. Yes. Because they have more opportunities to get treated. If you take UK or USA, they have more, or their treatment is sponsored by insurance companies. In UK, it is sponsored by NHS. So they have, they will get the right treatment. But our people don't have money to treat the disease, and we have to take the expenses from our pocket. So that's also another problem. Dr. Kurian, what's your experience?
Sir, I think that we modern medicine people give guarded prognosis for these patients. So when other doctors or other treatment modalities, when they suggest that these diseases could be cured by them, it's eventually that very natural that they will go behind them and give a try. So I think we cannot actually go for giving this guarded prognosis with these patients. So it is natural that these patients try other modalities.
Yes, you are correct. നമ്മള് സാധാരണ പേഷ്യൻസ് ഇത് തന്നെയാണ് സംഭവിക്കുന്നത്. നമ്മള് യാഥാർത്ഥ്യം പറയുമ്പോ പിന്നെ ബാക്കിയുള്ള ആൾക്കാരുടെ അടുത്ത് പോകുമ്പോ സാധാരണ ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മളുടെ അടുത്ത് വരുന്ന പേഷ്യൻസ് ഈവൻ സ്റ്റേജ് 4 ക്യാൻസർ ഉള്ള പേഷ്യൻസ് ആയിരിക്കും. അങ്ങനെയുള്ള പേഷ്യൻസിന്റെ നമ്മളുടെ അടുത്ത് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഞങ്ങൾ മേ ബി anything other than modern medicine, and they have told them that ഞങ്ങൾ ഇത് മാറ്റി തരാം. ആ ഒരു വാഗ്ദാനം അതാണ് അവർ കൊടുക്കുന്നത്. പക്ഷേ മേ ബി വിത്തിൻ 1 or 2 months the patient general condition will get deteriorated and they will come to us, and at that time only they will think that okay, even after taking these medicines the general condition is deteriorating and now he is terminal. Now we understand that it is not useful. That's what usually happens.
Yes, sir. Actually, I think because of this psychology of this patients will always remain. I think we cannot actually change it, and people will be always there to exploit them.
Yes. That's correct. എന്നുവെച്ചാ ഇപ്പൊ മുങ്ങിച്ചാവാൻ പോണ ഒരാള് ഒരു എന്താ പറയാ ഓല തുരുമ്പ് കിട്ടിയാലോ അത് കയറി പിടിക്കുന്നു പറയില്ലേ. ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ലൈക് ദാറ്റ് ഓൺലി ദേ ആർ സംബഡി ഈസ് giving some promises that okay, we will we'll try to get a cure, or we will make you cured. So if they hear about that, then they want to give a try on that medicine. That's what happens.
Yes, Dr. Jishnu, you wish to add something?
One point is that older days smoking was just a, what you can say, smoking was just some
symbol of pride or something like that. Then we started campaign, we started from the schools, educated the children like that. This thing also, we can do it like a campaign, just like going to the schools, educating the children that this evidence-based medicine should be followed, no other like that in families like that. Then for next generation, we can control somehow.
Okay, that's a good suggestion, Jishnu. The situation will improve with what you have suggested, but still there will be some people who want to try other things. In the abhiprayam parnalum, or whatever be the action you are going to take, there will be two types of people. All of that. So there will be, it's natural to have, the problem will persist, but that's one way that we can decrease this the practice of quacks.
ഇപ്പൊ ഇന്ന ഒരു മെഡിസിൻ ഞാൻ കഴിക്കുമ്പോ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് മരുന്നല്ലേ, അപ്പൊ അതിനാണെങ്കിൽ സൈഡ് എഫക്ട്സ് കൂടുതലല്ലേ സർ? അപ്പം അങ്ങനെ ഒരു വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ്, എത്ര എഡ്യൂക്കേറ്റഡ് ആണെങ്കിലും എത്ര എഡ്യൂക്കേറ്റഡ് ആണെങ്കിലും നമ്മുടെ വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ ആയുർവേദം അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മൾ അങ്ങനെ ഹോമിയോ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഓക്കെ, നമ്മൾ എത്ര കഴിച്ചാലും ഇല്ല, അതിലൊരു സൈഡ് എഫക്ട് ഇല്ലെന്നും നമ്മൾ അലോപ്പതി അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അഥവാ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് മെഡിസിൻ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് അതിൽ സൈഡ് എഫക്ട് ഉണ്ടെന്നും. സോ സർ, ആ ഒരു വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് ലൈക്ക് എങ്ങനെ മാറ്റണം? എല്ലാ ലൈക്ക് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് irrespective of education or uneducated, ellarkum our view point aanu ippol po adengena samarthanda.
All these are very difficult questions. Anna cheyna idu nammalde samoohathile adu പണ്ട് തൊട്ടേ ഉള്ള ഒരു കാര്യമാണ്. കാരണം നമ്മളുടെ ആൻസസ്റ്റേഴ്സ് പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്തിരുന്നത് നാച്ചുറൽ മെഡിസിനും ആയുർവേദിക് മെഡിസിനാണ്. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടാണ് മോഡേൺ മെഡിസിൻ ഇവോൾവ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ എന്താ വെച്ചാൽ ഈ ആയുർവേദിക് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നാച്ചുറൽ മെഡിസിൻസിന്റെ ആ ഒരു ഇത് നമ്മളുടെ എല്ലാ ആൾക്കാരിലും നല്ല രീതിയിൽ വേര് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ നമ്മളുടെ ഇപ്പോഴുള്ള ആൾക്കാർ അവർക്ക് എല്ലാവർക്കും ആ ഒരു ആയുർവേദിക് മെഡിസിനെ കുറിച്ചുള്ള ഒരു അവയർനെസ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അവരുടെ തിങ്കിങ് ആ രീതിയിലാണ്. അതിന് പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് സൈഡ് എഫക്ട് ഒന്നും ഇല്ല എന്നുള്ള രീതിയിലാണ്. അപ്പൊ പക്ഷെ ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മളുടെ തലമുറ ആവുമ്പോ ആ ഒരു ചിന്ത മേ ബി കുറച്ചും കൂടി കുറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ടായിരിക്കാം. കാരണം നമുക്ക് ആ ഒരു സിസ്റ്റം ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഡയറക്റ്റ് ടച്ച് ഇല്ലാത്തത് കാരണം, പിന്നെ അത് മാത്രമല്ല മോഡേൺ മെഡിസിൻ കൂടുതൽ ആൾക്കാർ പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് കൊണ്ടും കൂടുതൽ ആൾക്കാർ അങ്ങോട്ട് പോകുന്നുള്ളത് കൊണ്ടും, അപ്പൊ അത് എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു അത് ഗ്രാജുവലി തന്നെ ഉണ്ടായി വരാനുള്ളൂ. അല്ലാതെ നമുക്ക് ആർക്കും അങ്ങനെ മാറ്റിയെടുക്കാൻ പറ്റാവുന്ന ഒരു കാര്യമാണെന്ന് എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നില്ല. ഇപ്പൊ തന്നെ എനിക്കറിഞ്ഞൂടാ നിങ്ങൾ എത്ര ആൾക്കാർ വായിച്ചു എന്ന്, ആയുർവേദിക് മെഡിസിൻ കഴിച്ചിട്ട് ലിവർ ഫെയിലിയർ ഉണ്ടായി എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഒരു ജേണലിൽ ഒരു പബ്ലിക്കേഷൻ വന്നിരുന്നു. PBS ഏതോ ഒരു ഡോക്ടർ പബ്ലിഷ് ചെയ്ത ഒരു ജേണൽ ആർട്ടിക്കിൾ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. എന്നിട്ട് ഇപ്പൊ അതിന്റെ പേരില് എന്തോ കേസൊക്കെ നടന്നുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുകയാണ്. അപ്പൊ ആയുർവേദിക് മെഡിക്കേഷൻസിന് പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് സൈഡ് എഫക്ട് ഒന്നും ഇല്ല എന്നുള്ളത് അങ്ങനെയല്ല, സൈഡ് എഫക്ട് ഉണ്ട് എന്നുള്ളത് കാണിക്കാൻ വേണ്ടിയിട്ടായിരുന്നു അങ്ങനെ ഒരു ഇത് ജേണൽ പബ്ലിഷ് ചെയ്തത്. യെസ്, ഹലോ.
Sir, I think it is basically the problem of modern medicine itself, sir. We always tell the patients that our medications have side effects, but rather the other treatment modalities, they don't actually convey the patients about the side effects. From the beginning, we always tell the patients, yes, these medicines have side effects. Maybe it's true, but still we have actually counseled the patient like that. And also we always keep ourselves safe. We never taste the risk while counseling the patient. So I think it is because their this approach towards the patient that has kept this English medicine, the approach of the English medicine from the public, it is because our own way of approaching the patients, I think, sir.
Okay, Kurin, you may be right because we are talking about the side effects of medicine, and even if you are making the patient to undergo a surgery, you will take an informed consent. Even for chemotherapy, you will take informed consent. This medication for surgery will cause this and side effects, all this. But I think that is what we have.
Sir, it's unavoidable, but since the scenario has to persist, there is no actual solution. It will go on.
Yeah, but if you look at the ethical aspect, we have to talk to the patient regarding the benefits and the side effects. Actually, if you are giving something which is not usual, so I think it's our duty to discuss. So we can't avoid it.
Yes, sir. Actually, the small difference is, I feel it is not unavoidable, sir, but I feel like we always take a concept to keep ourselves safe rather than conveying the patient that there are side effects, that these things could happen to you. But our way of counseling the patient would be actually usually on the other side, to keep ourselves safe. That small approach could, I think, can change the way the patient could approach us.
Yes, I understand, Dr. Kurin. I think what you have told is correct. It's always, consent is always to protect us, not to inform the patient regarding the complications. Yeah, you are correct. So the way to communicate should be changed. Yeah. Lithin, Praveen, or anybody else have anything to add regarding psychosocial care or anything else?
Yeah, that in the first, I was just listening to all you were talking, and in the first case, I came across that the intervention of the doctors or the medical team in that case, because especially they talk with the DFO and they try to arrange a job for that guy, and that is a very good that we have to appreciate. We appreciate that you intervene in that scenario and you try to find out a solution, and all financial crisis, emotional problems was evaporated from that family. That is a good thing. And in the as a whole, these three cases, that everyone discussed, that it revolves around the same thing which India or any other developing nation is facing. Especially in India, our people are ignorant. They doesn't know what is the real factor or what is the real benefit of medicine. Or when we talk about campaigning awareness program, in my opinion, these two terms are very dangerous things. It's just like double-pointed sword. We have to use it in an appropriate way. Then only it will reach the people. Because I will cite you an example. Very recently, our Kerala government had a campaigning against alcoholism, consuming alcohol and all. And very recently a report came, a report was published that it was a failure, that the number of alcoholics are increasing day by day. It is not reaching the people. Why? Again, where the government is spending thousands and lakhs of rupees for awareness and campaigning, but it is not reaching to the people in an appropriate way. Here lies the main issue of our country or our state, that it's never reached the people in the appropriate way. At the same time, when we publish or when we put a video in a social media or a Facebook or a WhatsApp page, it will directly reach them, and they will take it as a Ramayana or Mahabharata of their life. They will take it and they will trust it. Why this is happening? Because these negative things are overpowering the positive aspects of our medical system. It is not reaching in an appropriate way. The campaigning's awareness program should be modified in a way that people should listen to it, that prominent personalities have to be brought to it, and the way should be like this, that we should bring the upper strata of our society. We always think that the middle class and the lower class people are obviously have to listen to our words, and they have to, we are the teachers and they are the students. that kind of approach is always creating a barrier in this issue. So that when it comes to, if we want to create an awareness among people, we have to bring this upper strata of our society or the people who are come out of this program. The problems, that means the person who was an alcoholic before and he got de-addicted. Then we have to bring these kind of people into the picture and we have to share their experience to the people who are alcoholics or who are a chain smoker. Then only it will make any change. Otherwise, if a person, a medical professional or a person who belongs to our health department, they will go and take a class. Most of the time, it doesn't make any impact because in my experience, it is in the case of adoption also. In adoption also, the same barrier is there. Our adoption, state adoption resource authority used to create or implement a lot of awareness program. And it is, but the adoption rate in our state or in our country is going down, down, down. This is the same problem because the patients or the parents who adopt the child are not willing to come out, or our authorities are not promoting them to come out and talk to the people. We adopted a child. Or our legal, even if I am informed right that your legal system is also making it very confidential, the details and all that things are very confidential, that if someone adopt a child, it has to be meant confidential. There are some social issues related to this. But even though, when the patient or a person who is directly affected by and survived from this scenario comes in front of the people and give them an awareness class or a campaign, then the impact will be different. Because I myself have witnessed several cases like this who have changed or came back from these kind of scenarios, especially the alcoholism. And then with this, thirdly, we have to go with our medical and all other support. Then only it will be more effective. And one more thing, actually, when I was listening to everyone was talking, it sounds everyone is very desperate. Why these patients are behaving like this? That is that is the voice which I heard. In my opinion, my country, India, is a country of poor people. The layman, they doesn't know nothing, but we have to push it further, further and further. Then only it will reach at least 1%. If we can do 1%, it's okay. But we have to take time and compel them again and again and again. Then only our country will be a developed nation today or tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Praveen. So I just want to make one more point. The last point which Praveen told, our government is working opposite to that because government is trying to integrate Ayush, isn't it? So we don't know what we can do in this matter. But let's hope for good in the future. Rajalakshmi, I think
we are having 5 more minutes, so any queries or anything you need to say?
Rajalakshmi, I think we will stop.
Sorry, I didn't get it. Okay, sir. So, I think we feedback. So, I have given the feedback link in the group chat. So, please log in and do it. So, we will see you on Thursday with Delirium taken by Dr. Seema Rao. Thank you all. Thank you for joining. See you on Thursday. Bye.